like to be without ya.
Come is the invitation of the whole Bible. The cross in all languages means come to the cross, find salvation. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest.
Come on, you! Put your hands together, let's worship!
Dawn of creation, life revolves in the orbit of you. Set your plan into motion, each life a story of your grace. Jesus is the way, he's the truth, and he's the life of us. So call upon his name and have the faith that he can save you. Just
overcame all, praise to you, and it's you that's gonna save my friends. Thank you. rejoice in the Lord. Come on, who tonight believes that the Lord, come on, he's got strength for us tonight. Enjoy. So, man, hey, why don't you tap your neighbor as you go back to your seats? Tell him you love him. Tell him you look good tonight. Let someone know. Hey, ask your friend, ask your neighbor. Hey, you coming to Anthem Night next week? Welcome to Ocean's Youth. Yeah. Say I won't rap. Okay. Invite a friend. Anthem Night. Invite a friend. Let's go. Hey, who's glad they made it to Ocean's Youth on a Sunday night? Come on, come on, come on, come on. Well, hey, tonight is going to be an incredible night. Got so many incredible things in store for you. We have Pastor Melissa preaching the word tonight. It's going to be fun. And just a few announcements. But before we get into announcements, everybody say generosity. Come on, someone say generosity. Tap your neighbor and say, I'm generous because I'm using your book. No one has a checkbook. I was going to say that. Dear Lord, just dismiss that joke. I'm using your Cash App tonight, okay? Hey, we are a generous church, amen? Come on, who remembers Treasures of Heaven a couple weeks ago? Talking about the idea of sowing and reaping. We are a generous church, but we are a generous youth ministry. And was just thinking about the idea of generosity, thinking about sowing and reaping. Someone say sowing. Someone say reaping. How many of you know that you don't get something that you don't sow? So if you want healing, come on, you sow into praying for God to heal you. If you want a miracle home, come on, for my wife and I, we got to start praying for that miracle home. Whatever it is in your life, you will not reap where you don't sow. The same goes with our money. That we won't reap a great harvest, the Bible says, until we sow into the kingdom of God. And so tonight, here's my thought, is next week is Anthem Nights. Nadezhda's excited about. Come on, next week is Anthem Night. And it's going to be, I promise you, if you were at Fall Festival, you know we go crazy, crazy hard on nights like these. It's going to be an incredible gospel message. We've got a new song we're singing. We've got merch we're bringing. We've got food trucks. There's so many cool things. But here's my thought tonight. Tonight, you find yourself a week out of Anthem Night. You're in church. And here's what I know, is if you want to reap a harvest that says, God, what could you do in my generation? Sow into it tonight. I don't care if it's $2, if it's $5, but sow something into tonight saying, God, I want to see you move next week. I want to see you move in my life. I want to see you move in my friend's life. I want to see you move in my school life. Some of you are seniors in here. You'd say this, hey, I'm going to sow tonight expecting that God is going to do something so great next week that it's going to touch the generations behind me. That maybe you're not going to see the crazy revival at your school, but maybe it's the sowing that you do tonight. Come on, we believe this. This isn't magic. This isn't twisting any ankles. The Bible says we don't twist arms for you to give. We really believe in the principle of sowing and reaping. And so this is not giving and getting, but this is sowing and reaping. And when I sow into God's kingdom, I get more of God's kingdom. When I sow into Apple or when I sow into a stock or when I sow into some clothes, I'm not reaping anything but then just the product that I'm buying at that moment. But when you sow into the kingdom of God, the Bible says it multiplies. You catch that? That when you sow into God's house, when you give money to God's house, it actually now has the power to multiply. Nowhere else does this work. Nowhere else does anybody have this offer or anything like that. No, but when we sow into God's house, God multiplies it. So this is what I'm expecting, that if 120 of us in this room, so $5, it's not about the money. It's about what we're contending for and sowing into. So this is my thought, is Anthem Night is next week. Yes, it costs money to do that, but that's not why we're giving tonight. We're giving out of a place of God. I know that when I give, you have the power to bless and you have the power to multiply. So God, if there's 120 in here, man, I'm sowing believing there'll be 240 in here next weekend. So I'm excited about it. I know I'm giving. I know I'm sowing. I know I'm believing. I'm praying into next week. But you're here tonight, and maybe you're new, and you're like, why are we talking about money? I know not many youth ministries talk about it, but here, we believe in generosity. We don't believe, what did I say? We don't believe in giving and getting. We really don't. We really believe in the principle of giving because we have a generous God. The Bible talks about it, and so we talked about it a couple weeks. If you missed, you can rewatch those messages on tithing and generosity, but I'm going to pray for us real quick. Then I got a few announcements for us. Father, we just thank you for tonight. Come on, if you're giving, just lift up your phone or anything like that. God, I just thank you tonight that, Lord, as we give, God, I pray that, Lord, you would multiply the seed that we sow. I pray there'd be a great harvest that we would reap. God, I even pray for next week at Anthem Night. I pray even right now as we sow in faith, God, that you would do miracles, that, God, young people would get saved. And I just pray that, Lord, the heavens would be opened up, God. Would you multiply tonight in Jesus' name? Come on, someone say amen. Amen, amen, amen. Hey, someone say announcements. If you are new here, we'd love to get you connected. Easy way you can do that is you can scan the QR code. If you've never scanned it and you've been here a million times, why don't you scan that thing? We'd love just to know who you are, where you're at. But second announcement, someone say second announcement, is we have our high school hangouts coming this Tuesday. You can, we're excited, all of our high schoolers, we're going to be hanging out at a clubhouse. It's supposed to be 75 degrees, and so if it stays nice, if the weather's still permitting swimming weather, we're going to swim. If not, we'll update it, and we'll let you know kind of where we're hanging out. So tomorrow, check socials. Tuesday, check socials, or text your small group leader where high school hangout is going to be. We'll put all the information on Instagram as well, so we'll give you all the updates for Tuesday. Anybody excited about that? And the next week, I said it already, but Anthem Nights is next Sunday night. We are so excited. Invite up. Come on, you guys are not excited about anything tonight. Come on, tell your face you're happy. I'm excited. I know God's going to move. I'm excited because I know what's going to come. I know that God is going to meet young people. But I know this, that we're going to have a lot of fun. We've got merch. We've got food trucks. We've got, I don't even know. We got a new song, like I said. So many fun things that are going to happen next week. Don't miss, if you're a youth student and you come regularly or you're watching, don't miss next week, and then invite a friend. And here's a cool thing. Drum roll, please, real quick. Drum roll, please. I'm so sorry for putting you on the, okay, anyways. Drum roll, please, drum roll, please, drum roll, please. Next week, we are giving away a free scholarship to camp. Come on, that's awesome. So, thank you, babe. Next week, if you invite friends, you're going to get put into a raffle to have your whole camp paid off and paid for, which is pretty awesome, which is my next announcement. Yeah, that's $350 of a scholarship. But next week, invite your friends. It's going to be awesome. So many cool things. Repost it on social media. Let all your friends know. Not a better night in the entire year that you can invite a friend to than Anthem Night. Amen? And then we do have summer camp coming up July 28th through the 31st. You can register already online. We haven't even fully pushed it on our socials yet, but there is the registration is filling up already. Here's the cool thing. Some of our team, we went to the campground this week, and it is incredible. So much fun is going to happen. The facility is amazing. There's AC in the dorm rooms. It's going to be awesome. You're like, praise God. That is a big deal when it's 90 degrees and your AC smells and it's hot, okay? No one likes that, and it's not just the guys' cabin. Girls, y'all stink too, okay? So, no, I'm joking. I'm sorry. But it's going to be an incredible, incredible time. We are going into the woods of San Diego. God is going to meet us there. We've got some special announcements that we're going to be promoting and pushing even just next week. So, I'm excited for summer camp. Hey, tonight, come on. We've got an awesome, awesome SNL in store and ready for you. So come on, if you are ready on credit, come on, put your hands together, clap, get excited for what God's gonna do the rest of the night.
Get hype!
Come on!
Hey! That video was fire. I'm fired up.
A little preview of what's going to be happening tonight.
Oh.
Yeah. All right.
Let's get the lights on real quick. Lights on
so we can see you guys, see your faces. All right. We have 12 contestants tonight. If you guys can stand to your feet. 12 contestants.
12 contestants. Hey.
Hey, I like it. Hey. What are we doing?
Hey, like you guys saw in the video, that was Tiger Woods. Who watched the Masters today? Nobody, only the guys in here.
It's okay.
It was a golf tournament, and Pastor Melissa, that's why she's the GOAT. Watch the Masters. All right, 12 contestants. Me in the middle by the putting green.
Judah, are we going to go?
We're taking the floor.
We're going to have a little.
We're going mobile.
Yeah. All right, get our 12 contestants to the middle.
Everybody in the middle. In the middle. What are we doing tonight, Kai?
Well, we're having a little putting competition, all right? Who wants to go first? So, crowd, we have a little putting green right here. If you guys want to stand on your feet, you guys just stand up and come to the middle.
Hey, stand up.
Stand up, get here
Let's
to the middle.
Let's give them a fire environment
all right.
here.
So, we have three junior high boys, three junior high girls, three high school boys, and three high school girls. We will see who makes a putt, and towards the end, we'll have a final showdown. Everyone's going to go crazy. It's going to be great.
If you miss the putt, you're out. So, it's one and done here. One and done.
Let's go.
Hey,
start it
boys,
off.
Line
start
up.
It off. Line it up.
Line it up.
Hey, I need everyone to crowd around. Scoot in. Hey, let's go.
Hey, we'll introduce them real quick. Right. Okay.
That's all right.
Hey, you're going to have to go righty. What's your name before you putt?
Jackson.
Jackson's going to putt. Hey, let's make some noise for Jackson right now.
Make some noise for Jackson. No pressure. Hey,
let's
get
go,
loud,
Jackson.
Crowd, come
hey,
on.
Hey, get loud. Make it hard on him. Let's go, Jackson. Okay, he's lining it up.
He's locked in. First one of the night.
Oh, okay. The practice swing.
Oh, a little practice. Okay. All right.
Okay. Okay, Jackson, let's get it going here.
Here we go. No.
Hey, it's out.
Okay,
it's
out. Good try.
Jackson, you
first,
can head to
you
the
went
side.
First? All right, let's see it.
Okay, who do we have here?
Hey,
Josh.
We got a big prize for this, all right?
Big prize for this. Hey, let's make some noise for Josh as he lines
Josh,
his butt up.
Let's see it, Josh. Hey, have the next person ready to go. Here we go.
Let's go, Josh.
Josh.
No,
it's okay.
You missed. That one was better.
All right.
That one was better.
Hey, crowd, when this goes in, I need everyone to go
if
crazy.
If it goes in,
right?
Go crazy.
Come on, Kaysen. Let's see it.
Oh, Kaysen.
Oh,
0-3.
Close.
Hey, high school boys are.
It's okay. Savannah.
Did not show out.
First of the girls.
Okay.
Can I hear from the girls?
What's your name?
What? Savannah.
Savannah, let's make one here. Way too
it's okay,
hard.
It's okay.
That's
good
okay.
Job. Good job, Savannah.
Hey, throw us the ball.
Hey, we're good. Hey, let everyone know who you are. My name's Jacob.
Hey,
give it up for Jacob.
It's
come
his
on,
first
Jacob.
Time tonight, Ocean's Youth. So
all right.
He's that guy.
Hey, come on, first time.
Let's go, Jake. Oh, no.
It's okay. Just so everyone knows, we're trying to get it in that hole.
We're trying to make it in the hole
here.
Right,
here we go. What's your name?
Wait, I'm a lefty.
What's up?
I do it this
What's your name?
Faith.
Faith, everyone get up for Faith.
Hey, Faith, you might have to go the other way.
The putter is for righties, but you can try it. Just do it. Yeah.
Oh. Oh.
Oh. Whoa,
oh. Oh.
It's okay. Good.
I like
great
the
try,
pace.
Faith.
Great hey,
try.
Great
try,
Faith.
All
the lefty, right. That one was, that's
who
an L.
Who is going to be the one to make
hey,
this
Hey, we need
game.
Someone
let's
to make
go.
It.
Bradley, come
let's
on.
Go, Bradley.
Let's see it.
Come on, Bradley.
Come on.
Line it up. Oh. Oh, okay.
Close.
Okay.
Come on, Shavi.
Hey, Shavi. Here we go. Shavi sunk it.
Let's go.
Okay.
Let's go.
Okay.
Okay. Let's go.
Okay.
Let's go. Okay.
If no one else makes it, Shavi wins.
If no one
but
else makes it,
if
Shavi
someone makes
wins.
It, we're going to
but
a playoff.
We still have a few more.
All right. What's your name?
Good.
Stella.
Good word, Shavi.
Skyla. Hey, give it up for Skyla. Here we go.
Skyla.
Here.
It's Stella.
Stella.
It's Stella.
I heard
Stella.
It wrong.
Stella.
That's
Stella.
My
it's
bad.
Okay.
Give it up
Let's
for
go,
Stella.
Stella.
Oh, that was pretty good still.
Okay.
That was
okay.
better than a bunch of other
okay.
people.
Do we have a few more? Okay.
Who's next?
All right, here we go.
What's your name?
Quinley.
Here we go.
Give it up for her. Oh, she went right away.
Wait, it's okay. Great try.
Good try.
Evie, you're up. All right. Let's go, Evie.
Come
on, Evie.
Line it up. You just hit it.
Evie.
You just hit it. You're good.
Yeah.
Oh.
So close, Evie.
How many people do we have left?
All right, our last one, Kenzie Francie. Let's go.
Is this the last person?
Kenzie, let's see it.
P Mike's going after this too. So Kenzie.
Okay, let's go.
Big pressure
Kenzie.
Here.
Here we go.
Okay.
You got this, Kenzie.
Let's go, Kenzie.
She's locked in.
Oh! Off the back wall! Hey!
Let's go!
That was crazy!
Okay.
Hey, Kenzie, Shavi, come up back to the front. It's Kenzie versus Shavi in the playoff.
All right. Last one.
We're going shot for shot.
Whoever makes it first. Shav, let's go.
Okay, here we go, Shavi.
Shavi. I need everyone to go crazy.
Okay.
Kenzie gets a
try. If Kenzie makes it, she wins.
Whoever makes it first.
Kenzie. Okay.
Let's go.
Get in the hole!
Ah! Hey, we have a winner. Hey, give it up for Kenzie, everybody. Off the back wall twice. Hey, that was crazy.
Shout out.
Hey, Kenzie is your 2024 Masters champion.
Come on.
That was SNL. We're taking a two-minute break.
She is our... Give her the jacket, bro.
If I pitch you this out of the park, moving so quick, it's like they stuck in park. They see the numbers, but I see the heart. 10,000 hours you spent in the dark, putting in good work, even though you didn't even know that it would work. Talking about a man who grew up in woodwork, do it for the love of it, that's the way it should work. Yeah, yeah. I know some people gonna look at me crazy, and I'm like, for what? Man, I was stuck. I was down, but now I'm up. This all got this. Like a seesaw when I'm on a beat, like an old man's lawn, better keep off. From the ground to the treetops, got clouds on my feet like Jack and the Beast. I jumped off quick, went straight in a free fall. Cowboy hat and a mic singing yeehaw. Landed on my feet like a feline, put him back in the seat like a recline. Ay, what you mean I'm not worthy? Did it with a purpose, didn't need a permit. Digging from the bottom and I brought it to the surface. Mind your business now, who I worship? Who the little guy making big, big, big moves? Tick tock, turn it to a tick, 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 boom. Yeah, I talk a lot of stuff. Till I went and turned it where I was down, but now I'm up. Let's go. This all got this ain't no love. Yeah, I used to be stuck in that mud. Yeah, I was down, but now I'm up. I was down, but now I'm up.
The number you have dialed is not available at present.
Yeah, trendsetter, whoa, league of my own, it don't get better. No, read what I wrote, I'm a bestseller. Yeah, read for my...
Okay, come on, we're gonna keep worshiping and just lifting up the name of God with our voices. If you would just come back to your seats, you could stand up with us. Come on, God is in this place, and we know that when we meet with him, anything can happen. Lord, everything is possible with you. So let's just lift him up. Let's pray together right now. God, we just love you so much. Lord, we know that you're here. We acknowledge your presence in this place. And our hearts right now are just to meet with you, Father. We need you. We need your spirit. God, whatever we came in here with, Lord, we give it to you. Thank you for lifting our heavy burdens, Lord. Thank you that your presence just... yeah, that it just takes it all away from us, Jesus. So we just need you right now. We invite you in this place. Come on, if you want to invite him in this place, why don't you just lift your hands? You can close your eyes. Come on, don't look at your neighbors around you. This is just time for us to just focus all our attention on the Lord, to hear what he's speaking to us and how he wants to move in this room. So God, we just focus all our attention on you right now, Lord. There's nothing like your presence, Jesus. Come on, let's sing this out together. There's no place like your presence. Nothing can compare to the wonder of heaven. Feel it draw me near. Spirit of God is here with us. There's no place like your presence. Let's sing that again. There's no place. There's no place like your presence. Nothing can compare to the wonder of heaven. Feel it draw me near. Spirit of God is here with us. There's no place like your presence. And just one touch, and I'm never the same. Just one.
Change.
it takes is just one touch. But we just want a moment with you, Father. 'Cause you're a good, good Father. Won't you come in? Won't you come in vain? Won't you come in vain? Come fill us up. Lord, we want to see your face. Won't you come fill us up? Come on, sing that out if you want a moment. Just come fill us up. We want to meet with you, Lord. Oh, come fill us up. You're the only thing we want right now. Won't you come fill us up? Won't you come, won't you come? Come fill us up. You're all we want, you're all we need, Lord. Oh, come fill us up. There's nothing else, there's nothing else. Won't you come fill us up?
Lift up our hands, we close our eyes, we thank you that you are in this place. We thank you, Lord, that the world offers an experience, but God, you offer an encounter. And we thank you tonight that, Lord, all it takes is just one touch. God, I thank you, Lord, for the woman that had the issue of blood. It just says she reached out and touched the hem of your garment. God, we thank you tonight that it's not by might, it's not by power, but it is by the Spirit of the living God tonight. I thank you tonight, whether we are weary, God, whether we're hurting, or whether we come in every single week and we're fired up to be here. I pray tonight that, God, you would meet us here in a mighty way. God, would you touch us with your hand? God, would you meet us in a way that would leave us, God, changed forever? I thank you that Moses, it says he went up on the mountain and he came back down a different man. I thank you tonight that when we encounter the living God, I thank you that it is the presence of God that begins to change us. And so I pray tonight, God, whether we are tired, whether we're struggling, or whether we're having a great day, I thank you that every single time we meet with you, we don't have to be in a bad place, we don't have to be in a high place, but God, your promise is that you meet with us. And so I thank you tonight, God, I thank you for a young person, I thank you for a leader, I thank you for a church that values the presence of God, that values saying yes to you in moments like this. Why? So we can encounter your presence. It's reminded of Ephesians 3:18. It says, how deep, how wide is the love of God? I thank you that tonight, whether we've experienced your love in a small way or in a grander way, I pray tonight we would come into a new revelation, a new knowledge of how good your love is. God, I thank you that tonight we're not serving a small God. God, I thank you tonight we're not serving a finite being somewhere out there in the cosmos. But God, tonight I thank you, even as young people, ages 12 to 18, I thank you tonight we're worshiping a great and grander God. So I pray tonight, God, would you shake us up in this place? God, would you do something in us? God, would you stir up faith in us, God? I pray tonight would not be like the same old, but I pray from the leader to the student. I pray we would be reminded of how deep, of how wide, of how grander, of how majestic, of how great your love is for us, God. Come on, do I got anybody that believes with me for a moment? God, we thank you tonight that you are the God of all gods. You are the God of the ages. You are the God of yesterday, today, and forever. And so tonight, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are in control of every issue, of every problem that we are facing tonight. And we thank you that you are our source. We thank you tonight that you are the solution to the problems we've been having lately. Pray the prayers that I just sense there's been young people praying prayers and you feel like it's been going empty-handed. I thank you that tonight you hear the prayer of the righteous. And I thank you that tonight every young person that walked in here that's going to leave that once an encounter will leave with an encounter. We thank you tonight. Come on, it's just one touch. I think it's just one touch of your presence, one touch of your love. I think it's just one little glimpse of how good you are tonight. And everything could shift. Everything could change. So, Father, tonight, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for your presence. And come on, with a loud shout of an amen. Come on, put your hands together. God, we just thank you for how good you are. Come on, in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, say amen. Come on, put your hands together. Say amen. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, hey, tonight is going to be an awesome night. You can take your seat. We've got a great, great, great night in front of us. Pastor Melissa is preaching the word. But before that, why don't you check out this video?
To go to camp this year. If you're not convinced by that video, I don't know what's going to convince you at this point. Last year was awesome. I remember the worship being so powerful and so good. You do not want to miss out on camp this year, especially after going and seeing it. It was incredible. If you love snacks, this is for all my middle schoolers, we have a snack shack for you. You can get burgers, you can get ice cream. It's gonna be a fun time. And if everyone agrees, say amen. You can sign up, you guys, right now on the website. It's gonna be incredible. You don't wanna miss it. We have limited availability too. So the earlier this you sign up, the better. So go home, talk to your parents, right? It involves their money, their wallet. Unless you have cash, then that's great too. But you don't wanna miss out. I'll say this, at camp is where I encountered God. At camp is where he met me face to face. And at camp is where I became from dead to alive and in him where I found my purpose and all the things. So I encourage you to come. If you don't know who God is, come to camp. If you want more of God, come to camp. If you want a fresh filling and the outpouring of his spirit, come to camp. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm excited to be here. If you don't know who I am, my name is Melissa. I am married to Pastor Micah. We're the youth pastors here at Ocean's Youth. It's been a long time since I've been up here. I've just been busy, you know. I'm just pregnant every year, if you didn't know. I'm a mom of three little boys. I have an almost three-year-old, Nash. And then I have a one-and-a-half-year-old, Graham. And then I have an eight-week-old, Levi. I was like, what's his name? I don't know. Someone texted me the other day and they were like, hey, baby dedication's coming up Mother's Day. And I was reading the text. I was like, why are they texting me about baby dedications? And then I realized, oh my gosh, it's because I have a baby and I need to dedicate him. So that's where my mind is at.
But I'm happy to be here. I made it. I'm back up, and I'm excited. Who's excited for the word tonight? But before we get into it, I wanted to honor one of our leaders, Nadej. If you didn't know, she's on The Voice, and she's with us this week and next Sunday, but then she's going to head back to being on the show, and so we just wanted to pray for you. We had some encouraging things that we said to you. We wanted to honor you. So can you join me in praying for her as she goes back on the show? Father, we thank you for Nadej. God, we just thank you for the joy and the gift that she is to everyone around her. God, I thank you that you put her on that show for a reason. And so, God, I pray, Lord, that your glory would shine upon her. I pray that your presence would fill her as she goes back. I thank you, God, that her coach and the people that she competes against would feel the love of the Father. I thank you, God, that they would feel even just the love and the compassion of Nadej's heart. So, God, I pray you would anoint her lips. I pray, God, that you would give her mission and vision as she's there. And so, Jesus, I thank you that you favor her because she is a daughter of the Most High. So, Jesus, we honor her. We bless her as she goes back. And so, Jesus, we thank you for everything you're doing in and through her. And we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. We love you. Well, hey, if you're taking notes, which I encourage you to do, maybe you could pull out your phone or if you have a journal. My title tonight is called Getting Off the Bench. Getting off the bench. If you have your Bibles, does anyone have a physical paper Bible? Ew! Come on. If you don't have a physical Bible, I will go to the store with you. I don't know what store. I shop on Amazon. So maybe we'll shop on our phones together, and I'll help you pick out a Bible, and it'll be great. A physical Bible, there's nothing like a physical Bible. It's just like, ooh. It hits different than the phone. It just does. Maybe try it out. If your phone's not hitting, maybe try that. Amen. Okay, tonight we're going to turn to James chapter 1, verse 22. James is in the New Testament towards the end of the Bible, if you need to flip through it. If you're there, say, I'm there. No one's there. You're there? All right, we're going to start. James chapter 1, verse 22. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself, goes away, and at once forgets what he looks like. Can you imagine? You're getting ready for school in the morning, you look at your face, turn around, you start walking, you're like, wait a second. What did I look like again? Crazy. He looks at himself, goes away, and at once forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, Jesus, perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts. He will be blessed in his doing. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for tonight. I thank you for every person that had the courage to come. I thank you, God, that you would speak to each and every one of us. Holy Spirit, we give you all access and authority to our heart and to our mind. We draw close to you tonight, Jesus. We thank you for who you are and how much you love us. In your name we pray, amen. Amen. Thank you, Hannah. Can you guys give it up for her? She's the best. So growing up, I didn't play a ton of sports. You might think I look athletic, right? Yeah. No, I'm tall. I got really long arms. I was always made fun of because in worship, you could point me out and see me like, oh, where's, Mike would always make fun of me because he's like, where's Melissa? Oh, there she is. Because I'm like, I'm reaching high in the sky. You would think that my arms would be put to use for something, but it wasn't. So you can just find me in worship lifting my hands. But I didn't play a ton of sports in high school. The only sport I really played was volleyball. I started out in eighth grade, and I did club. I had no idea what I was doing. It was one of those, like, I didn't play a sport. I'm the youngest of five. None of my siblings really played any sports, so it wasn't, like, encouraged. No one was like, you should do this. Even my parents. My parents didn't grow up doing sports. My mom did gymnastics. I tried that for, like, a month, and I was like, not for me. And it was because my friend wasn't there and I was little and I was like, I don't want to go if my friend's not there. And so anyway, so I do volleyball because my friend was doing volleyball, power of friends. So in eighth grade, I started out in club. I'm surprised they even let me. I think it was just because you're in eighth grade still. So they let everybody. So it's like I really shouldn't have been able to join the team. But because I wasn't really good, I had no idea the moves, the plays, right? There's like footwork to volleyball. Not sand volleyball, but like on the floor volleyball. I know sand volleyball is really popular here, right? Isn't there guys that play? Josh, let's go. Yeah, let's go. See, I wish I knew. I'm not very good at sand volleyball. That is another skill in your leg muscles. Okay, anyways. But you have to know the like footwork to volleyball, bump set spike. You have to be able to hit the ball like well. There's a way that you can hold your hands to be able to bump it. And all the things. So there's moves, there's plays, right? In any other sport, whether it's basketball, whether it's football, you have to know the plays, you have to know the moves, you have to go into conditioning. I remember for volleyball, our conditioning was insane. She made us do, so our coach, she was an Olympic coach. Crazy, Boise, Idaho. Woo, shout out. But she was there, but she was hardcore. I'm like, you guys, I'm a freshman in high school. Sorry, I fast forwarded. I did eighth grade in freshman year. But she was intense. And I was like, oh my gosh, why are we sprinting? I don't understand. Why do volleyballer people, why do we need to sprint? Why do we need to do? I feel like this is a track workout. Why am I conditioning for track when I'm like playing volleyball? Honestly, we didn't even hit a ball for weeks. It was running. And then I didn't realize it's because when you're like standing like this for a long time during the whole game, you like can't breathe like because of like the way that you're positioned. So when you run, it like trains your breathing to be able to be in that position. Anyways, so that's for every sport, right? You have to condition, you have to know the plays, you have to know the moves to be able to get in the game confidently, right? And then when you do, that's when the game becomes fun. When it's like you're not just sitting on the bench watching the players because you didn't prepare, right? Or you didn't go to practice enough, or maybe you didn't condition enough, or you didn't study the plays. So you're sitting on the bench, right? Because we all know that's the hard part. I knew I'm not that good of a player because I'm on the bench. I was on the bench warmer. I was warming up, okay? Because when you're on the bench, right, sometimes that means it's a lack of preparation, or a lot of times it just means someone's better. That's called a starter. But I made my way a little bit later. You guys, my freshman year, I almost made the sophomore team, but I like couldn't keep my eyes open when I jumped to block the ball. To this day, I can't keep my eyes open. I don't know how anyone keeps their eyes open when they jump over the net. I like don't get it. I still close my eyes. So frustrating. So I would have never honestly made it to the varsity team, which is fine because I started going to youth and volleyball was, you know, on Wednesdays. And I was like, well, sorry, volleyball, I'm going to youth. Anyways, but when you're in a sport, right, there's preparation for all those things, and the sport comes alive when you get into the game. And in the same way, our faith comes alive when we decide to not just hear the word, but we do the word. So we see in James, there's two groups that are being called out. The first is, if you're taking notes, a hearer. A hearer is someone who forgets the moves, forgets the plays. They don't do any of the conditioning. So because of that, they don't have the confidence to get off the bench and get in the game. So they're sitting on the bench. A hearer, it almost makes me sad. A hearer is someone who they miss out. They miss out on the fun. They miss out on the joy of what it's like to get into the game. It made me think about, I don't know if I just only know Travis Kelce because of Taylor Swift, but I'm going to say I didn't, you know. But you know, my in-law family is big Chiefs fans. Like, they get my kids' jerseys, and they're all hardcore. My mother and father-in-law, you should see their gear. So it's not because of Taylor Swift. But who knows? Anyways, it made me think, can you imagine being in the Super Bowl and you just sat on the sideline and you were on the bench while you got to watch? You still got the ring. You still got to say, I went to the Super Bowl, but you watched and you didn't get to experience the joy of getting into the game. And a lot of times that's our faith, right? Being a hearer, maybe you accepted God. You're still going to go to heaven, but you're missing out on the fun that God has intended for you to live in, the joy, the freedom that he has intended for you in the everyday life. And that is what a hearer is. A hearer, what happens when we become hearers? We'll start to notice our faith falling flat. Have you ever felt that way? Maybe you come to church every week and it's like, I don't feel like I'm seeing a change. I don't feel like my soul is healthier. I don't feel like my mind is more free. I still feel bound. I'm still in this cycle. I still struggle with this sin and I can't seem to overcome. But I come every Sunday and I'm here and I keep showing up. And I think a lot of us think it's sufficient in a hearer. Think it's sufficient to know God's will, but not do it. How many times do maybe we know the will of God, but they're like, I don't feel it though. I don't feel like I want to do the will of God. When I'm at school, and maybe I should say this, I don't feel like doing the will. I know it, but knowing it and doing it are two different things. And when we become hearers, we might know the will, but we don't do the will. I think I think of someone like myself in high school. I had a Bible verse in my bio. You know, John 3:16, Philippians 4:16, whatever, 13. Well, I liked 16 if you go a little lower. But, maybe I was a real Christian. I don't know. Maybe you have a Bible verse in your bio, you call yourself a Christian, but when it comes to it, when someone comes to you, asks you about Jesus, maybe you don't know what to say. You don't have anything to give them. A hearer is someone who hears the word and it goes out the other ear. So maybe you might call yourself a Christian, but there's no fruit in your life. If your friends don't know you're a Christian, I love this, Micah says this all the time, if your friends don't know you're a Christian, then maybe you're not. If your teacher doesn't know, then maybe you're not. If your siblings don't know, then maybe you're not. How you know that you are a follower of Jesus is by your fruit. Not just because of your attendance, not because of what you hear that makes you holy, that makes you godly, but it's by the fruit of your life. It's by the outcome. It's by who people notice, right? So that is what a hearer is. A doer is someone who has gone to practice, went over the moves, remembers the plays, and because of that, they have the confidence to get into the game. When they hear the word, they act on it. They get off the bench. And because of that, they experience the joy, the freedom, and the life that God intends for us to live here on earth. What happens when we become doers? We'll start to notice our faith become alive and our faith become real. It won't just affect you, but it'll affect everyone around you because faith is contagious. So when your life begins to transform, your parents will see it, your siblings will see it, your school will see it, and they'll start to say, hey, what happened to you? Why do you talk different? Why do you look different? Your face doesn't look angry anymore. You look lighter. You look brighter. Something happened to you. What happened to you? You'll begin to see that your life transform. Why does it transform? Because you begin to act on the word. And when you act on the word, you activate it. I love what the word says. The word is alive and it's active. And it's sharper than any double-edged sword. It cuts through bone and marrow. It pierces and heals at the same time. What does that mean? It means the yucky stuff in your life, as you act on the word, it is it cuts it off, but then it heals you. So the things that you need to cut off in your life, when you act on the word, those things cut off and are no more. In the places of your heart that need healing and get restored. Because that is the way that God has intended us to live. He hasn't intended us to be hurt puppies that walk around everywhere, that are insecure and that are not confident, sitting on the bench, watching everyone else have fun. Why are Christians mopey and like, oh, I don't want to have fun. My life is so hard. But I have Jesus. That's crazy. You have Jesus and your life sucks? That's an anomaly. That actually can't happen. That means there's something you're not doing or activating, is what I should say, in your life. And when you act on the word, you activate the word. And I'm telling you, your faith becomes so real and so alive. Why do you think people dedicate their life to preaching the gospel? It's not like it's an easy thing to do. I told Micah, I was like, props to you. It is not easy writing a message. I was like, help me. I need help. It is not an easy thing to be a pastor, to write a message, to pray through things, to feel the burdens of people. It's not a desired job. But you know why people do it is because they experienced something so real, so good, so powerful that we just can't contain it, but we have to tell everyone about it. Right? It's the same way when people experience darkness. Because darkness is just as real, right? It's not as powerful, it's counterfeit, but it's just as real. And it's funny how people that experience darkness are so loud about it. Has anyone ever experienced that? No? Yes? Maybe? It's on TikTok, Instagram. They're so loud about darkness. They're so loud about their agenda. But where are the Christians? Why aren't we loud? Why don't we tell them our stories? There was a story that I love. Micah went to the gym. I think he played basketball. And these two guys, I don't know who he was with. Shout out some of you guys. But he was leaving the gym, and these two guys stopped him. And they just, like, had a conversation. I think they were asking you how to work out, right? No. Yeah, no, they were like, how to play basketball. So it was just kind of, like, weird. But he took it as, like, all right, God, maybe you want to do something. So he had fun with the conversation, and he told them about Jesus, and then he invited them to Easter. And one of the guys, he was like, man, you're like the second Christian tonight that has told me about Jesus or invited me to church. And he was like, but I don't feel like that happens anymore. He's like, why are Christians so silent? And Micah told me that, and I was like, oh my gosh, that is so sad. And I think we have allowed the agenda of darkness and allowed the enemy to make us crippled in fear that we just want to not, we don't want to offend anybody. We don't want to get any under anyone's skin. We don't want to fight, which it's not about fighting. But it's if they're going to push their agenda. Come on, we need to rise as followers of Jesus and tell them, no, there's actually a truth. There is one way, the only way, the truth and the life that we do follow that will set you free. And I think that is what God has intended for all of us, right? That there is one way. And I love that when we act on the word, it teaches us to forgive. It teaches us to love our neighbor, to humble ourselves, to be kind, faithful, gentle, self-controlled. It teaches us how to pray. It teaches us how to steward our money. It teaches us the power of the Holy Spirit. It teaches us that we can believe for healing and we can pray for healing. It teaches us His power and His authority, that we don't have to be afraid, but He reigns and He rules. And He holds the whole world in His hand. And most importantly, it teaches us His grace and His love for us, that He didn't come into the world to condemn us, but He came into the world to save us. And that is how good God is. And sometimes religion, it comes off so yucky. It comes off condemning. It comes off with rules and regulation. But can I tell you that that's not how Jesus comes off? That's not what Jesus intends for you. Jesus comes with his grace. Jesus comes with his love and his compassion. He's slow to anger. He's not an angry God. He's not an angry dad, but he loves you and he's willing to wait. And he gives us a choice to come and serve him. We're not robots. He didn't make us to be robots. He didn't make us choose him. And that's the beauty of the gospel, is we have a choice to love him, to be with him, to be free, but it's up to us. And he's just waiting with open arms. That's how good the Father's love is. So we hear the word, we act on it, becomes alive and it becomes real. And that's when it begins to transform you from the inside out. I remember when I was in high school and we had a camp in Donnelly, and a lot of you know this story already, but I was 15 years old and my pastor was Pastor Mark, and he's our lead pastor now. But I got invited to church, and I was in that boat of like, I'm more of like a hearer right now. I'm not acting on anything. I enjoy youth. I'll come, and it's fun, but I'm not doing anything with my faith yet. And I went to camp, and at the end of the service, kind of like last week when Pastor Micah had prayed for some of you, that happened to me at camp. And Pastor Mark prayed for me, and he laid his hand on me, and I'll never forget that moment. Because in that moment, God became real. It was like the light switch turned on. And I was like, oh my gosh, I am experienced the one true God. He knows my name. He knows the things that I've struggled with growing up. But he loves me. He's there for me. And I remember weeping. And I don't even fully remember what he said. I just know that I was going to be a supermodel, not for like, not literally, but for God. And that was one thing that God was going to use me in my school, which he did. God was going to use me in my family, which he has. And it touched me in such a deep way that I was never the same. But when he prayed over me, it didn't just stop there. It didn't just stop with like, oh, that was a good prayer, Pastor Mark. Thank you. Thank you for praying for me. I then began to act on the word that he prayed over me. And I began to live on mission for what he had prayed, because the word began to transform my life. I let it transform my life. And I think a lot of people, they miss out on a transformed life here on earth because they're stuck at being a hearer of the word and they don't ever become a doer. I know a lot of people in my life, family members, friends, they call themselves a Christian, but you could still see that they're missing out on so much. And it made me wonder, how many of us come on a Sunday? Maybe we're hearing it, but when we walk away, maybe someone prays for us. Maybe we get a word of encouragement. We hear the word, we walk away, but we're still the same. We leave carrying our anxiety still. We leave stuck in our depression. We leave stuck in our sin still. We leave stuck, even though you just heard the word, even though you were in an environment where the Holy Spirit was present, maybe you know the Bible, but you still remain stuck. It's like, I feel stuck in my mind, and I feel stuck in my spirit. Maybe you feel like, I don't know if Christianity is working. I don't know if coming to church is really working because X, Y, and Z. I'm not seeing much of a change, and I don't know what to do. And I think if we understand this simple truth of not being a hearer, deceiving ourselves that just because we come doesn't mean we're transforming if we're letting it go in one ear and out the other. And I think if anyone knows this to be true, it's the author of this book, which is James, the half-brother of Jesus. Right? They technically have different dads, but the same dad. How weird, right? You could study that later if that doesn't make sense. But some scholars don't believe that he was a believer until Jesus died and rose again. So James, brother of Jesus, grows up with Jesus, lives with him 33 years. Can you imagine all the things that he heard from Jesus? all the teachings he heard about Jesus, all the things he saw about the disciples, the things that he experienced and witnessed, and yet he didn't believe. And it took until after the resurrection that he realized, oh my gosh, Jesus is the one true God. He is the one that God had sent to save us. Can you imagine the joy that he felt, but also the sorrow of he missed it? He was with Jesus. He was in his presence. He heard him. And it took till after, right? Until he caught a glimpse. I think James, when I was studying this, it felt like it came alive to me. The passion in his hand, the burning in his heart when he wrote this. Because if anyone were to understand, it's him. That he was a hearer. And he deceived himself around Jesus. He looked at himself, still didn't know who he was. He forgot. But then he caught a glimpse of who Jesus was. And he began to act, and he began to do, and I could feel the passion and the burning of his heart of saying, don't be like me. Don't miss out on what God has for you. He missed out for 33 years on what God had for him. And it wasn't until after. And you know that this was so real for him because he later became one of the greatest apostolic leaders of Jerusalem. Then he led this massive movement. And then he later died for his faith. You want to know how he died? He got stoned to death. Rocks. Can you imagine rocks being thrown at your head and that's how you die? But that's how you know how real it is for you. That's how you know that you've encountered something so deep, so real, so holy, so blameless, so powerful, that you're willing to be stoned to death. I think if we can learn from anybody, we can learn from James of just the burden that I felt and the sorrow, but yet the joy of like, man, this is what I've learned, so you do it. Don't miss out on the realness and being alive and being and having fun. Don't miss out. You have the opportunity. You have the choice every single morning when you woke up. If you still have breath inside your lungs when you wake up tomorrow, you have a purpose. You have a plan. God has something specific in store for you. You are not just a bunch of atoms that were made up for no flipping reason. But God has intended something for you. You have a name, you have a story, you have meaning, and you have life. So when you wake up and you're still breathing, you say, God, I'm here, I'm listening. I don't want to be a hearer, but I want to be a doer. The heart of God is for you to live a life that is transformed here and now, being a doer of the word, not just a hearer. It's time to get off the bench. It's time to get off the bench. Three quick points, and then I'll be done. How we get off the bench is, number one, we remember the word. I love Audrey this morning. She spoke in a surf club. Shout out, surf club. Beep. She talked about the importance of hearing the word, or remembering the word. And I love something she said is, how can you remember the word, or how can you even remember something you haven't taken the time to know? So first, importantly, to remember the word, you have to take the time to know the word. You have to open up that Bible and begin to read it. This is what I love. I read this about Harvard. I sometimes like to read science things because science just backs up what the Bible already says. This is what science says about remembering. How you remember something is, first, you have to get the information into your memory. Then you must keep that information around. This is called storage. It's like pressing the save button. Then you'll be able to bring that information to mind in the moment that you need it. But unlike a computer, you must continually restore the content in your brain. which I thought that was so powerful because that just describes Psalms 1, that meditating on the word day and night. And I love that science explains it. You have to make the memory, so you have to start with reading the Bible. Then you got to keep it around, and then you got to continue to restore the content. That's why we say when you open up your Bible, it's not just a once a week thing. It's not just a once in a moment thing, but we got to keep restoring the content, because when you have a moment that you need it, you're going to be able to pull it out. But what happens if we don't restore it, we don't keep it around, the moment that we need it, I stop seeing you at church. The moment that we need it, you get lost in the world. The moment that you need it, you go back into your old ways. The moment that you need it, you don't have it. Why? Because you didn't start remembering. And your brain has no content because you didn't keep it around. And I love what this says. It says, Harvard said, why do we forget? It says, if we fail to remember, what happens is we're just not devoting enough effort or paying enough attention. That's not me saying it. That's science people saying it. That's people with degrees I don't have. If we fail to remember, what happens is we're not devoting enough effort or paying enough attention. If you see the fruit of your life and it's not good fruit, are you devoting enough attention to the word? Are you putting in enough effort? Or are you just letting your days go by floating in the wind? A lot of times the areas that I struggled in life, I wasn't devoted enough. I wasn't paying attention to the word, to what Jesus was speaking to me. I just kind of let it go. And my life was a mess. I didn't know who I was. I was insecure, just kind of lost in the crowd. I wasn't a follower, or I was a follower, not a leader. Just kind of like, what am I doing? But when we start to remember, meditate on the word day and night, meaning filling ourselves with the word, it'll begin to transform our life. We'll get off the bench and we'll become a doer. Number two, becoming a doer, we remember the word, but we also look to Jesus. When life is hard, or even when it's easy, who do we look to? Who do you look to? When life's hard, when it's easy, who do you look to? It'll show the inside of you. It'll show the real king of your life, or the real Lord. And maybe it'll show why you're still dealing with X, Y, and Z. I love Proverbs 4:25. It says, let your eyes look directly forward, your gaze be straight before you. Luke 11:34 says, our eye is the lamp of your body. When your eye is healthy, your whole body is full of light. But when it is bad, your body is full of darkness. Again, this isn't me talking. This is the word. This is Jesus. So if you're dealing with stuff inwardly or darkness within you, are you looking to Jesus? Where are your eyes? Where is your gaze? There's a world out there that is trying to get your attention. They're trying to, right, turn your gaze to everywhere but Jesus. Trying to turn your gaze towards darkness. Trying to turn your gaze towards crazy stuff. Right? I see it. So if I see it, you definitely see it. You see it probably more than I do. They're trying to get your attention, turn your eyes, confuse you, turn you away from the truth. So we have to pay attention to where we look. But that's only if you want a healthy body. That's only if you want a healthy soul. If you don't want to be healthy, go for it. If you want to be a trash can, go for it. I don't want to smell. I don't want to look like trash. Come on. I don't want to smell like trash. I don't want to be trash. God doesn't intend for you to be a nasty trash can. Sorry, that's kidding me. He didn't design for you to take on trash and to be that. He designed for us to be healthy, to live whole lives. Number three is we're a doer who acts. that's the most important thing that you get from tonight, is that you do and you act on the word. So when the opportunity presents itself, you go and you do. Because those who act, I loved in the Message translation how it ended the verse, was those who act will be blessed, but they'll find delight and affirmation in your doing, in their doing. So if your faith is falling flat, I encourage you, begin to act on the word, and you'll begin to feel delight, and you'll begin to feel affirmation in what you're doing. Begin to step out, encourage someone, give someone a compliment. Be vocal. Tell someone about the truth. Tell someone about the story about when you encounter God. Tell someone about Anthem Night. Why don't you encourage someone that we know the hope of the world, that we actually have an intimate relationship with Him, that it doesn't have to stay in the church, but it can go out of the church. Begin to be loud, to be vocal. And I'll end with this, and I think, and you guys can stand, actually, I'll end with this. You can turn the lights off. I think if this room were able to grab a hold of this word, not only would you see a massive transformation in yourself, but you would see it in your whole family, and you would see it in your school, you would see it where you work, because a transformed life is contagious, and it doesn't just affect you, but it affects everyone around you. It's time to get off the bench and get into the game. It's time to get off the bench and get into the game. You guys can close your eyes. I'm just going to pray for a couple of groups. I went too long, so we can't do small groups. Amen. I just want to pray for a group. It's like maybe you're a hearer. You've been coming to church. Maybe you haven't been acting on it. You haven't let it transform your life. You're still dealing with some cycles. You're still maybe stuck in some patterns and sin. And God, He wants to come. I think He wants to heal some of your hearts, heal some of your minds, and He wants to activate the word inside of you. So I'm not even going to look. But if that's you and you're like, man, I want to get off the bench. I want my faith to become alive and real. If that's you, you can just pop your hand up quick and down. I'm not even looking because it's between you and God. Father, I thank you for every hand that was lifted. I thank you that your desire is for us to live a life that is alive, that is real, that is fun, that is joyful and free. So Jesus, I thank you tonight, Lord, that you're charging this room to go from being a hearer to being a doer. I thank you, God, that we would begin to go out into our schools, that we would begin to live on mission for you, Jesus, that we wouldn't waste our teenage years. But God, in the area of one of our most influential times, I pray, God, that you would awaken us to your mission. You would awaken us to your spirit. And God, that we would live on mission and we would become doers of the word. And I pray, God, that our parents would see our transformed life. Our friends would see our transformed life. I pray from today on that you would resensitize our spirit, that we would hear the Holy Spirit, that each and every morning we would hear your voice and we would come running to you and we would partner with you. So I declare over this youth ministry that no longer will we sit on our hands and sit on the bench and watch and miss out on the fun, but we will lead the way of this generation knowing Jesus. We will lead the way of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And so, Jesus, I bless every person that raised their hand. In Jesus' name, and I just want to pray for one more group. We always pray for this. Maybe you don't know Jesus. Maybe you've never walked with Jesus, but his love for you is so great and so big. We always give an opportunity because we never know who knows him, who's serving him. So if tonight you're like, man, I want to know that God. I want to know the Father who loves me, who died for me to live a glorious life, not a life that is sad and slumped, but a life that is joyful. If that's you, on the count of three, I just want you to pop up your hand and we're just going to pray together. So on the count of three, one, two, three. If that's you and you're like, man, I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life back. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you guys can pray this with me, say, Jesus, I thank you for what you did on the cross, that you died on the cross for my sin and my shame. Thank you for the blood that covers me and makes me new. Make me a doer and not a hearer. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can you give it up for those who gave their life to Jesus? I think it's too late for small group time. Okay, well, here's the best opportunity to act on this message. Okay, this is your assignment. If you are a doer, we have the best opportunity this next Sunday, Anthem Night. You have the opportunity to invite all your friends to come to this night because it is going to be powerful and so good. So this is your opportunity. Say, I'm a doer, and I'm going to invite. In Jesus' name. Hey, amen. Well, thank you for coming tonight. We love you. You're welcome to hang out. Feel free to linger. If you need prayer, we have leaders that are willing to pray for you and be here for you. So I encourage you to do that. We love you guys.